We will disassemble and reassemble the mechanical fuel pump from a VW Type 1 engine with carburetor in this video. The electric fuel pump is discussed in another video. The fuel pump push rod and the fuel pump flange get extra attention in this video. On this didactic setup, you can clearly see the parts of the assembled fuel pump. At the top, you have the fuel pump itself. The fuel pump is attached to the engine crankcase by means of a Bakelite flange. Bakelite has the property of insulating heat well. The Bakelite fuel pump flange ensures that the fuel in the pump does not become too hot. The fuel pump flange slides into the crankcase by means of slide fit. This means that the fuel pump flange, by applying a little force, slides in the crankcase. This is so for the original VW flange. Replacement fuel pump flange can be thinner, we will see this later in this video. The fuel pump is driven by a metal drive shaft, also called push rod. This goes up and down, to the rhythm of the drive shaft of the distributor, and thus the crankshaft. Through this up and down motion, a vacuum is created inside the fuel pump, which draws the gasoline from the gas tank through a gasoline hose. The other flexible hose from the fuel pump connects to the carburetor. The connections are different for different fuel pumps. We now disassemble the fuel pump from our AB1300 engine. Loosen the two nuts. Remove the nuts and the washers. With the fuel pump disassembled, you can see the push rod. Remove the paper gasket between the fuel pump flange and the fuel pump. Now you can remove the push rod from the crankcase. Note the assembly, the rounded side down and the flat side up. The bottom of the push rod on our AB1300 is flattened, this is a sign of wear. There are also obvious signs of corrosion. The length of the push rod is 107.68 mm. The length should be 108 mm for this type of engine. We take a new push rod, you can see that the bottom is nicely rounded. The length of the new push rod is exactly 108 mm. Due to wear of the old push rod, the pump will have slightly reduced efficiency. Excessive corrosion is also a reason for replacement. We now search in the Paruzzi online store for push rods for the Type 1 engine. For the Type 1 engines, there are two types of push rods, one measures 108 mm, the other 100 mm. The longest one measures 108 mm, and is meant for the Type 1 engines up to and including July 1973. The 100 mm push rod is for the engines from August 1973 onwards. On the 25 and 30 horsepower engines, the fuel pump push rod is arranged horizontally. Both the push rod and the distributor drive shaft are different from the younger engines. We remove the push rod from our AS1600 engine. Note the assembly, the rounded side down, and the flat side up. The length of the push rod from the AS engine is just under 100 mm. Of course, both types of push rods are not interchangeable. We look at how the push rod of the AS engine moves when the engine is running. The push rod remains in its lowest position, just above the fuel pump flange. We turn the crankshaft pulley until the push rod is in its highest position. In its highest position, the push rod rises 4.57 mm above the pump flange. We are measuring here without a gasket. If we look at the bottom of the fuel pump, we can see that the lever can be depressed by a little more than 5 mm. Mounting the 108 mm pushrod in a crankcase intended for a 100 mm pushrod will cause serious damage. We use an old 1200 crankcase to show how the pushrod is driven. This is a short pushrod of 100 mm. Clearly, if we used a 108 mm pushrod, the fuel pump and drive shaft would be damaged. The reverse is less of a problem, the fuel pump just won't be driven. It is very important that the push rod has a good tread against the distributor drive shaft. The Bakelite fuel pump flange will play a big part in that. Now let's pay attention to the fuel pump flange. In the middle is the old original flange that we took out of our AB1300 engine. It's broken off at the bottom, it came like this right out of the crankcase. On the right is a new replica or imitation fuel pump flange. On the left is a new original VW pump flange. This part is supposed to slide into the crankcase with slide fit. This means that with some pressure, either by hand or using a rubber mallet, it will slide into the crankcase. The diameter of the original old pump flange, at the level of the oil intake hole, is 14.93 mm. The replica is a sloppy 1.30 mm thinner. No question of slide fit in the crankcase with this flange. The new VW fuel pump flange is 0.60 mm thinner than the original pump flange. Here you can see how the original, albeit broken, pump flange slides neatly into the crankcase and stays tight. The oil suction hole is just above the crankcase opening, so it can suck in oil to cool the push rod. The danger of too much play is that the push rod does not slide enough against the drive shaft of the distributor, resulting in premature wear of the drive shaft and push rod. The oil intake hole disappears into the crankcase, losing its function. The hole is simply too low for this type of engine. Poor lubrication of the push rod and lack of cooling will be the consequences. The new VW fuel pump flange slides well into the crankcase, though with a little more play than the original. The oil intake hole is just right and will be able to perform its function properly. When the crankcase halves are split, then disassembling the fuel pump flange is very easy. You can try the method with the hammer and the pin extruder. The result will be that the fuel pump flange is removed and is lying in pieces on your workbench and in the crankcase. That in itself is not so bad, as long as you take care not to damage the crankcase. A fuel pump flange with 100,000 km on it will not be reusable anyway. The Bakelite breaks, pulverizes, by the years of excessive heat and oil residues. If you still need to disassemble the fuel pump flange without overhauling the engine, for example, because the flange is cracked or damaged, you can use the following method. You will need a thread tapping set, a piece of threaded rod end, and a puller set for this. This thread tapping set has 3 thread taps for each thread size, to cut the thread in steps. Here you see the 3 thread taps, with attachment lever, that we will use to loosen the fuel pump flange. We will use the M10 taps, because our puller also uses M10. Use a cutoff bolt, or a piece of threaded rod. Attach 2 M10 nuts, and tighten them firmly together. See how far you can tighten the threaded rod into the fuel pump flange without cracking the flange. The pump flange is reinforced to a certain point, so it is safe to tap a thread to the center of that reinforcement. Start by tapping the M10 thread into the fuel pump flange. We use the first tap to reduce risk of breaking the flange. Use the second and third taps to further improve the thread. Using the two-nut method, turn the threaded rod as far into the fuel pump flange as previously determined. Attach the puller. Make sure the puller pushes firmly against the crankcase. Attach the puller to the M10 threaded rod. With the puller firmly in place and the threaded rod firmly seated in the puller, you can begin to loosen the fuel pump flange. Tighten the nut on the puller. The fuel pump flange should come loose without too much force. With any luck, the pump flange will slide out of the crankcase without damage. Check if the fuel pump flange is still complete. If it is, you won't need to split the crankcase. If not, as with this A2B1300, Bakelite particles will have gotten into the crankcase. Splitting the crankcase is the only solution to get those particles out. We will now mount the fuel pump. There are 2 paper gaskets between the fuel pump and the crankcase. You can install the gasket dry, but on old engines it is recommended to use liquid gasket. This liquid gasket requires you to apply very little to both surfaces, and wait a few minutes for the liquid gasket to dry a bit. Make sure the surface of the crankcase is clean and flat. The first gasket is the one cut out on the inside. Install the new fuel pump flange, with or without a liquid gasket. If the fit is a little tight, use a rubber mallet to tap the pump flange into the crankcase. Be very careful, Bakelite is very brittle. Install the second gasket, with or without a liquid gasket. Slide the push rod into the pump flange. Make sure you use the correct push rod. A 100mm push rod should be used for this AS1600 engine. The rounded side of the push rod should face down. The flat side up, against the fuel pump. If the push rod is at its highest point, it will cause a lot of resistance when mounting the fuel pump. Turn the crankshaft pulley until the push rod is at its lowest point. Mount the fuel pump and secure the 2 nuts with washers. Attach the fuel hoses. New gasoline hoses sometimes dare to tighten very tightly, and are difficult to slide over the fuel pump connections. Use WD-40, for example, to reduce the resistance. On this fuel pump, the upper connection is the supply, coming from the fuel tank. There is an arrow printed in the plastic of the cover pointing toward the fuel pump. The other connection is the one going to the carburetor. Caution! A different type of fuel pump will have different connections. Not sure of the connection on your fuel pump? Then use the following technique. Cut two fingers from a silicone glove. Secure these to the fuel pump connections with a rubber band or tie wrap. Using a driving pin, push the lever at the bottom of the fuel pump. The connection that pulls vacuum is the supply, the one that builds pressure is the carburetor connection. You can also do this with the fuel pump mounted, just turn the crankshaft pulley for the same result. Secure the fuel hoses with the correct clamps. In the next video, we will disassemble and assemble the crankshaft pulley. We will show different techniques, with special tools and with homemade tools. More information about all the parts and tools used in this video series can be found as comments under each video on our YouTube channel. See you soon.